So again, we're doing something very similar to what we did with sine and cosine, except we're going to do the other trig functions. So starting with tangent, because we haven't done tangent yet. And again, in the top corner, it left out the unit circle. I don't know why. All the labels are there. Just the circle and the axes didn't show up. I have no idea why. Some sort of communication issue between... This is a Word document, so I don't know. Sometimes I have issues with PDF files, but this is a Word document, so I don't know why they want it. But do your best, draw a fake unit circle, and you don't really need it, I guess, but there it is. So just like what we were doing yesterday, it says you don't have to do this, but I don't want you to forget the relationship between what we're doing and the graphs and the fact that these are triangles and this is trigonometry. So it's as if they're drawing onto the unit circle. And this time, if you'll look in here, I actually do have 3 pi over 4 and pi over 4. Those are not quadrangle angles. So we really could do those. So let's just do, I'm going to do this pi over 4 because it's right here. So it would be that triangle. There's your theta right in the middle. So when they ask me for tangent's TOA, opposite over adjacent, or in this case, opposite is y, it'd be y over x. That's where this comes from. Tangent is y over x because it's still opposite over adjacent. So in this case, because it's a unit circle, I know the ordered pair right here, and they gave it to you right here, happens to be square root of 2 over 2 and square root of 2 over 2. So if I put y over x, what do you get?
1.
So it's 1 right here. And so just remember that that is what you're doing every time. It's as if there's a triangle set up. We're just not going to set the triangle up each time because that's a waste of our time. We can just do y over x because they gave us all the ordered pairs. So go ahead and fill in what you would get. Alright, so I ran into an issue right here, because it would be y over x.
Undefined.
Because you can't divide by 0. So again, just like we did yesterday, you can ignore what's here in the middle. And these are ordered pairs. So I have the ordered pair negative pi 0. Because if you look again, it's not a regular coordinate grid, but this is a theta tan theta grid. So I'm going to plot negative pi 0. Negative 3 pi over 4, 1. And then I run into undefined. Now graphically, when you see undefined on a table, what is that? It's an asymptote. So I'm going to draw in a dotted asymptote just so I know where it is. I'll go ahead and do it for all of my undefined values. Oh, this one's a little. Okay, now, without putting it in your calculator and without knowing this, you probably wouldn't just make them curved because those look pretty linear right here. Now, if we were to go in and put in all the points in between, if we were to go in and to find pi over 8 and 5 pi over 16, if we were to go in and find those, you would see real fast that it's not straight, it's not linear, it's curved. But just like sine and cosine, if you also think about the fact that we get these values from going around the circle, it makes sense that they're curved. I am not great at drawing them, but... I've actually done pretty well drawing them today. It looks like that. Bless you.
Thank you.
We can go ahead and put it in our calculator and just look at it on our calculator because it'll probably be a little bit better drawing than what we did. And I went ahead on my calculator, and I'll show you how to do it real fast. by half pies, and today it's counting by quarter pies, like on your, grid, while it only labels the half pies, it's actually got grid lines. This is a quarter pie, half pie, and so three quarters pie. So it's counting by quarter pies. So I'm gonna make sure that my grid is counting the same way on my calculator. So when you go in, hit menu, you should already be on ZoomTrig, but hit ZoomTrig just to be sure. And when you do, when you go back and hit menu, window and window settings, you can see right now it's auto scaling. And yesterday I adjusted mine to count by half pies, but I wanna adjust this instead of auto scaling on the x-axis, because when it auto scales, it gives me a bunch of lines. I just want it to give me the quarter pies, just like what our grid has. And I also would like for my grid to look exactly like theirs. Theirs goes from negative pi to 3π/2. So I'm gonna, at the top, I'm just going to change this to negative pi. And I'm going to do 3π/2 here. So that it should look exactly like theirs. And then on my x scale, I'm going to do π/4. Make it quarter pies. My y scale, what is their y? Y's are counting by halves. What is the y goes? It goes down to -2.5 and 2. And that way my grid should look almost exactly like theirs. Okay, so now I'm gonna put in looks just like, pretty much just like what we drew. Okay, so go ahead and leave that in there. We'll go back and put cotangent in with it in just a second. So now we're doing the same thing with cotangent. At the top of the page, they remind you that cotangent is just tangent flipped over. So instead of y over x, it's now x over y. You're still setting up triangles, but because they gave us ordered pairs, I can just do x over y. Like that. Notice, what's the first thing you notice about the difference between tangent and cotangent?
They go in different ways.
Yeah, they go different directions. Tangent is rising, is a rising function, and tangent and cotangent is a falling function. What's the other thing you notice? You notice anything else immediately? It's shifted over. Your asymptotes are in a different place. So, here's one of the things that's going to be important, because what we're going to do, this week we finish out looking at what the actual graphs look like, because we have not just these, but we also have the inverse functions of these, arc cosine and arc sine and arc tangent. We've got to look at the graphs of those too. But once we look at all the graphs, we're going to start to transform these, just like we transform quadratic functions and square root functions and rational functions. They shift right and left and up and down, and they vertically stretch and vertically compress, and they also horizontally stretch and horizontally compress, which we never really did in Algebra 2 because our functions wouldn't work that way. They will in pre-K. radical. So we're going to start to transform these. So I want you to think about it for just a second. If I transformed this tangent function, and I just made it a vertical reflection, I made it negative tangent theta, what would happen to it? It would flip, right? And so all of a sudden, instead of being a rising function, it would be a falling function.
And that's the same thing.
And it would look, except for, it would look the same, but not where your asymptotes are. Because this one passes through 0, 0. Tangent passes through 0, 0. But cotangent does not. There's actually an asymptote at 0, 0. Now, what would happen, though, if I reflected tangent and shifted it horizontally? It would look just like cotangent. So, and that's what I said yesterday with sine and cosine. When you're writing a function, you can write it either way. Just one of them's going to be easier than the other. And it would certainly be easier if I have a falling function to start with to say that it's cotangent instead of saying that it's tangent and inverted. So it'll all start to click and make sense. Okay, so they're going to ask us a few questions on the back. And I'm going to put tangent up. Cotangent on my calculator and put it on the screen, and then we'll do the questions.
There's one.
Just.
So down.
Yeah. That looks so cool. Okay. All right. So, what is the y-intercept of tangent? Well, it goes through zero. What is the y-intercept of cotangent? Cotangent's red. Doesn't have one, because it doesn't, remember, it has an asymptote at zero, so it can't have a y-intercept. So I'd put just MA. Alright, on tangent, where do the x-intercepts occur? So remember, I'm counting by quarter pi, so that's 1, 2, 3, so that's 4, so that's pi. So my x-intercepts of tangent occur at the pi's, multiples of pi. Where do the x-intercepts of cotangent occur? On the half pi's. The pi over 2's or the half pi's. Okay, tangent appears to have vertical asymptotes. Where are tangent's vertical asymptotes? Yeah, the pi over 2's or the half pi's. And cotangent's vertical asymptotes are on the pi's. So look at those two things that you just did, x-intercepts and vertical asymptotes.
They're opposite.
That's because these are reciprocal functions of each other. Remember, they're buddies. So their asymptotes and their x-intercepts are going to flip. What about the range? What's the range of the function? Yeah, negative infinity to positive infinity. They go down forever and up forever. Notice what they did not ask you. They didn't ask you the domain. Why?
Because it'd be like this.
Exactly. It would be for, and it would take, I mean, there's no way you could write it all. It would be ridiculous to write it. The only time you'll ever see them potentially ask you for the domain of either tangent or cotangent is if they put interval on it, and they say, what's the domain between here and here? And then you would write, like if they told us, what's the domain between negative pi and pi? Then we could say, okay, it's this to this, and you move this to this. But other than that, they're not going to ask you because it's just too crazy to think about it. All right, so next question. This is an important question. Would the tangent function be considered periodic? And if so, I'm going to put my actual And if so, what is the period? Now remember what we talked about periodic. It's something that repeats itself exactly after a given number of x values. So is it periodic? Of course it is. It repeats itself exactly. The real question is, how long is the period?
1 pi.
1 pi. Because on your trip around the unit circle, now sine and cosine, they're both 2 pi. It goes all the way around the unit circle. But tangent can't be, because halfway around, quarter of the way around, you run into an asymptote, and it can't continue anymore.
Then it has to start over right after the asymptote and go again until it hits another asymptote. So the period can only be pi because of those asymptotes. Now, I want you to think about what you guys were just doing on situations. When you do sine and cosine, what can you do to find the other angle?
Cosine is probably negative and sine.
And then, or?
360.
Add 360. What about sine?
180 minus where you add and subtract.
360. Cosine and sine are both 360, and that's because the period is 360. You're going to run into another angle just like that one after a whole other trip around the circle. But what's the rule for tangent?
Add or subtract 180.
Or add or subtract pi.
That's because the period of tangent is only pi.
Oh.
So that's why it's like that. Okay.
Are both of them pi right?
Yes. Yeah, both tangent. And whatever their buddy is, their periods are the same. So secant and cosecant, which we're going to graph in just a second, have the same things as sine and cosine because they have buddies. Okay.
Okay.
All right, even or odd. So let's look at tangent. Is tangent even, odd, or neither? It has rotational symmetry because if I turn this upside down, looks exactly like it did right side up, which means it's odd. And they both are. They're both odd because they both look the same. Upside down, upside down. So these are both odd. We've already talked about how they compare graphically. Their x-intercepts is the other one's asymptote. That's a really good graphical comparison. One is rising, one is falling. Other than that, they're the same shape. One's just a reflection of the other, basically. Alright, so secant is buddies with cosine. Cosine is x, so secant is 1 over x. You're still setting up a triangle, but we can just use our ordered pairs because they gave them to us, so it's 1 over x. Now, on negative 3 pi over 4, it's 1 over x, and x happens to be a fraction, which is division, right? 1 divided by negative square root 2 over 2, which is really a keep, switch, flip problem. Anytime you see this notation 1 over something, you can just flip the fraction over and just flip this over. That does mean we have to rationalize it, because that would be 2 over the square root of 2, which has to be rationalized. You might be able to do it in your head real fast. Mm-hmm. What happens to your 2s?
It's such a square root of 2.
This one happens to be negative because the x y is negative. So it ends up negative square root 2. 1 over x, this would be undefined. I'm going to go ahead and put my asymptotes in before I grab anything else. All right, so negative square root of 2, in order to graph that, you kind of have to know where it is. So if you put it in your calculator with a decimal value, you can at least get a, like an approximation. Yeah, it's almost 1.5, so. All
Okay, so again, you wouldn't know if you hadn't seen one before or anything how to graph this without looking at it. Go like this. I'm going to put it in our calculator and actually look at what it really looks like since I'm not a great grapher. So now, real quick, let me explain kind of where that comes from, because that's like, it feels kind of random, because I said it's buddies with cosine, yet cosine is continuous and has no asymptotes, and this has asymptotes. But if you think about what it means, it sort of makes sense. It's cosine flipped over. So anywhere where cosine happened to be zero, which it was, hold on. So here's cosine. So anywhere where cosine happens to be zero, that zero is now in the denominator because we flipped it over.
Mm-hmm.
It'd have to be an asymptote, right? Because it's undefined. So that's what happens here. And if you look at it, you can actually, and sometimes you'll see them dot this in so that it makes sense to people. That's the cosine wave right there. So the cosine wave has been flipped over like this. So that's why this piece got flipped this way. That became an asymptote because it's zero. This piece got flipped up.
Mm-hmm.
Make sense? So that's where it comes from. Okay, so before I even do cosecant, what can you imagine is going to happen?
It's going to be like that, but translated.
Yeah, it's going to be just like this, but just shifted over. Because sine was just like cosine, but shifted over. Let's do it real quick. This time it's 1 over y. So we'll answer questions on the back. What is the y-intercept of secant? Well, secant, first of all, there's two things you can do. Number one, you look at the graph and look at it. It's the blue one. But secant is buddies with cosine. And cosine's y-intercept is 1. Secant's y-intercept is also 1. Cosecant is buddies with sine. Sine's y-intercept is 0. Which means cosecant can't have 1 because it would be undefined. So it's in A, or there's an asymptote there, so it can't have 1. X-intercept of either of these?
None.
They don't have any x-intercept. Where does secant appear to have vertical asymptotes? Well, remember, the vertical asymptotes are going to be all the places where cosine has zeros. So if you can remember where the cosine has zeros, you can remember where this has asymptotes. It should be at the pi over 2. Which means cosecants are at the pi's. All right, range of this function. Now it's weird, but it has one, and it's not so weird you can't write it.
Would it be negative infinity
yes.
to negative 1 and negative 1?
Yes, negative infinity to negative 1 bracket, because it does touch negative 1, in union with 1 to infinity. And that's the same for both cosecant and secant. Okay, so now I'm going to take cosecant off of this. Because the next question asks if it's periodic. Remember, periodic means it repeats itself exactly after a certain amount of x values. Repeats itself exactly. This one catches people sometimes. So, period is always peak to peak or valley to valley. It is not peak to valley. So I can't go, okay, it starts here and then that's the period. Nope. Because that's a peak and that's a valley and that doesn't work. I have to go peak to peak. So how far is it from here to here? Or on your page it might be easier to see. Yeah, it is actually easier to see on yours because it actually 2 pi. Now why would the period
be? Because it's 2 pi.
Because sine and cosine have a period of 2 pi. Alright. Is secant, this is secant, odd, even, or neither?
Yes.
Wait, what?
I said neither.
Oh, no, it is.
Even?
It's even. Because you can fold it right on the y-axis. And it's buddies with what?
Oh, that one's even. So then the other one's odd.
Yeah. Okay. It's even and cosecant is odd because they're the same thing as their buddy. We've pretty much already talked about G, about how they compare with the reciprocal, how they're related. Okay, so I'm going to give you guys this sheet. There's nothing to do on this sheet. This is just has all the information in one place for sine and cosine. Now, you will, again, it left out, I'll show you how to draw that in just a second. It left out, of course, a coordinate grid. You will eventually, I was telling first period today, you will eventually have to memorize all of this, but I don't think you'll really have to memorize all of it because I think we're going to use it enough that you'll just know it. There might be a couple of things that you have to go in and memorize. Like, I have to make a concerted effort with tangent and cotangent to remember which one goes through zero and which one doesn't go through zero and which one has asymptotes at the pi's, which one has asymptotes at the half pi's. I have to like think about it to remember that. But other than that, I think this stuff will just kind of, you'll just remember it because we are going to use it a lot. Okay. Let me pull it up the actual document so you can see where the grid is. I don't know why it doesn't show on your page. I mean, there it is. I printed it. I don't know. Isn't that weird? Why wouldn't it show? But that's first.
It's going to take a minute.
That's
it. Yeah, I got really cold.
That's crazy. It gets so hot when the air is off that it's freezing when it's on.
It was still good.
this stuff is going to be important because we're going to start to transform them. So in order for you to recognize whether or not it has been shifted or stretched, you have to know what did the original look like. So one of the things that we haven't really talked a whole lot about because it's unique to waves and curves like this is this word amplitude. Now y'all know amps, right? Okay, so now you know where it comes from. However many amps it is amplitude is from the midline to the top or the midline to the bottom because a wave is on the line. What's the word? Yes. Okay, whatever. It's the same. It's whatever. But amplitude, like when they're talking about sound amps, it's how big the wave is. That's how from the midline up and the midline down. And the bigger the amps, the louder it is, because that's your sound wave. So that's where the word amps comes from. It's from amplitude. And it's just from the midline up and the midline down. Now, the parent function of both sine and cosine have amplitude of 1. So the way we're going to know if it's been vertically stretched is if the amplitude is bigger than 1. Or if it's vertically compressed, the amplitude will be smaller than 1. You can't tell with sine and cosine by fat and skinny. Like we used to tell with quadratics, if it got skinnier, we would say, that's a vertical stretch, it's been pulled up. That won't work anymore because it won't get skinnier because that's going to be a horizontal stretch or compression, which we never got to deal with in Algebra 2 because of the type of functions we were dealing with. I think everything else is all stuff we've talked about. You know what period is, now you know what amplitude is. All this stuff, where the x-intercepts and the max and the mins are, I think if you can remember the x-intercepts and the amplitude, the rest of it should be easy. Because you don't have to necessarily remember all the other stuff because you know the amplitude's 1, so you should be able to figure out where the maximums are. Odd and even, I think that's it. Domain and range is listed at the top. So I think you know all that stuff. Did I give you both of them? No, I just gave you sine and cosine.
You gave us kind of some sine and cosine.
Did I give you other circular parent functions?
Yes.
Okay. I think it has, actually, see the graph of this one actually shows. So weird. It doesn't have anything on it that you don't know. We've talked about all that. So these, I'm sorry I didn't punch holes in them. I probably should have punched holes in them. Because these are what you're going to refer to when you need to look at what the parent function looks like. Because starting, probably not till Monday, but starting Monday, we're going to start transformations of these. So there you go. Okay, so that's it. We're done. And we should do it.